Well, good morning again. Our topic today is the angel of the Lord. We want to talk about the angel of the Lord today. We want to identify what the Bible means when it speaks of the angel of the Lord, function, the nature, the purpose of the angel of the Lord, and what it really means to us that we have an angel of the Lord. Now, the angel of the Lord is a title given, I believe, first of all, to Jesus Christ, but also to a selected angelic servant of God and Christ who is given specific tasks in furthering God's purposes among humanity. These tasks include giving the revelation of God, providing guidance, encouragement, warnings, and the execution of judgment on those who oppose God's purposes. Now, we won't look at all those facets today. We're just going to look at a few of them, and we're going to focus mostly on the aspect of Christ being the angel of the Lord and how that is true. But we want to begin by, first of all, talking about the word angel. The word angel in the Hebrew language is from a word, malach, and it simply means one sent, a messenger, whether from a private person or from a king or an individual, as according to Jacinius' Hebrew-Greek lexicon. If we would go to slide number 3, we have there some of the different ways that the term is also translated in the NASB. Also, as King James, you have some different ways, but you have messenger, ambassador, angel, angels, envoys, messenger, messengers. According to the Dictionary of Biblical Languages in Semantic Domains in slide number 4, it says that this word represents a supernatural being of a class creation that is God's servants in informing or proclaiming a message from God. That's the Hebrew equivalent of what we call angel. In the Greek, according to our next slide, it is from the Greek word angelos, and that simply means messenger. According to the Theological Dictionary of the New Testament, in slide number 6, angelos is one who brings a message or a messenger. In the New Testament, our next slide shows the usages of angelos, and as you see, most of the time it's translated angel, angels, or angels, and in a few places it is translated simply as a messenger, a message. And just to show you a couple of examples, we could turn to Matthew chapter 11. Verse 10 says, "For this is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee." And that messenger, we know, was John the Baptist, speaking specifically of John the Baptist. But the word messenger here is the Greek word angelos. It's the same one that we translate as angel. So this concept of angel simply means a messenger. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 7, Paul says, "And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the angel of Satan, to buffet me." Now, your King James doesn't say that, does it? But it's where it says the messenger of Satan, it's the Greek word angelos. It simply means messenger. Now, as we noted in the one Hebrew reference, there is what we consider a group of supernatural beings that we call angels. And they are angelic in both function and nature. But human beings are even described symbolically as angels. In Revelation chapter 14, we have what we call the three what? Angels' messages. But we know that these messages are given by messengers that are human beings. And that's us, right? In Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1, Jesus Christ is called the apostle of God. And we think of him as fulfilling the function of an apostle, which is one sent. But he's sent with a message, and so he can also be called a messenger or an angel. If we would turn our Bibles to 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verses 5 and 6, we see here the great focus of Christ and what he wanted to do. It says, "For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." Jesus came to this earth to reveal the light of the knowledge of the glory of God to us. He came to be the express image of the Father's person, as it says in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. In John chapter 1, verse 1, he is called the Word of God. He brings the Word of God to us. He shows us what the character of God is like. In John chapter 14, you remember that Jesus was telling the disciples, I am the way, the truth, and the life. In John chapter 14, verse 6, he says, no man cometh unto the Father but by me. And Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and it will suffice us. And Jesus said, have I not been with you so long, Philip? He says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. That's John 14, verse 9. And so as we see Jesus Christ, he brings us the message, as it were, about God himself. Now let's turn to Exodus chapter 23, and we find this expression, angel of the Lord. Notice in verse 20, he says, behold, I send an angel before thee to keep thee in the way and to bring thee into the place which I have prepared. And he says, I'm going to send an angel. Verse 21. Beware of him and obey his voice. Provoke him not, for he will not pardon your transgressions, for my name is in him. And in verse 23 it says, for mine angel shall go before thee. Now this is as we are hearing the words of God. And he is telling us, through Moses the prophet, that he has an angel. And that his name is in this angel. And to not provoke this angel, to obey his voice, because he has the power to forgive sins. Now, can you think of any angel in nature, a being that is angelic in nature, not function now, but in nature, that has the power to forgive sins? Who alone can forgive sins? Only God through Christ can forgive sins. Nothing outside of divinity, which the divine law reveals to us, can forgive or pardon the transgressions of that law. Now let's turn to Exodus chapter 3. In verse 1, it says, Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. Now verse 2. And the angel of Jehovah, or the angel of Yahweh. You notice that the word Lord there is in all capital letters. The angel of the Lord, and when we had our original slide number 1 up, it was the angel of the Lord, capital L-O-R-D, all caps, right? You know that when you see that expression in the King James Bible, it's simply referring you to the divine name. Okay? So it's just not the angel of any Lord, it's the angel of Jehovah, the Father. And it says here that the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. Now notice it says in this verse that someone called to him. Who called? It says God called to him. Verse 5. And he said, draw not nigh thither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, and the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And so the angel of the Lord comes and says that he brings the word of God. He says he is God. Now, interestingly, we could reference this in the book of Acts, in the story of Stephen. Acts chapter 7. And notice the commentary that Stephen gives here under inspiration. Acts chapter 7 and verse 30. He says, and when 40 years were expired, there appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai, what? An angel of the Lord in a flame of fire in a bush. He says it was an angel. And in verse 35, this Moses, whom they refused, saying, who made thee a ruler and a judge? The same did God send to be a ruler and a deliverer by the hand of the angel which appeared to him in the bush. So this angel comes, this angel of the Lord comes speaking the word of God. But remember, in John chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He is the Word of God come to us. And so Jesus Christ, he is that angel of the Lord. In the primary sense, in the Old Testament particularly. But not in every case is Jesus called the angel of the Lord, or the angel of the Lord is called Jesus. Because, for instance, let me give you an example. In the New Testament, in Matthew chapter 28, we could go to Matthew chapter 28 and verse 2. Let's read verse 1 first. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. The context is the first day of the week, the resurrection is going to happen soon. And where is Jesus Christ at this particular moment? He's in the grave. He's in the grave. Verse 2, and behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and set upon it. And he said, your father calls you, come out. Now here is someone who's called an angel of the Lord. It's not the angel of Jehovah, it's just simply the angel of the Lord. But it's not Christ, because Christ is in the grave. Isn't that right? That's right. And so does Jesus have a special angel, an angelic being, an angel in nature that also serves as his special covenant messenger? And I believe his name is found in Luke chapter 1. And verse 18 says, and Zacharias said unto the angel, whereby shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife well stricken in years. And now notice verse 19. And the angel answering said unto him, I am Gabriel, and stand in the presence of God, and am sent to speak unto thee and to show thee these glad tidings. He said, I am Gabriel, and I stand in the presence of God. And you know what? Throughout the Bible, you don't find any other angel ever mentioned by name.
That's right.
Not an angelically function and nature being named, except this one. And he says, I stand in the very presence of God. You know, Revelation chapter 1 verse 1 says it's the revelation of Jesus Christ which God gave unto him, and he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. His angel, that he has a specific angel. Now, in that part of Revelation, he's not identified right there. But notice, I want you to go to the book Desire of Ages on page 99. And there it says of Gabriel, the Savior speaks in the Revelation saying that he sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John, Revelation 1:1. And to John the angel declared, I am thy fellow servant with thee and with thy brethren the prophets, Revelation 22 verse 9, RV. Now that RV means a revised version. So Ellen White here quoted from a Bible that wasn't the King James Version in this instance because she felt like it was a better translation, conveyed the message better. So sometimes we do that when it can... It's when it's true and accurate to the Greek or the Hebrew, and when it conveys it a little clearer, sometimes she would do this occasionally, and she did it here. And then it goes on to say, wondrous or wonderful thought that the angel who stands next in honor to the Son of God is the one chosen to open the purposes of God to sinful men. Isn't that beautiful? That's beautiful. And so we have this expression, the angel of the Lord. We know it can mean Jesus Christ. We know it can mean Gabriel. Perhaps it can be expanded beyond that, but we don't have a definition that we can clearly show from inspiration. But it's like this. Anybody know what this plane is? What do we call this plane?
Air Force One.
Well, is this Air Force One? Actually, it's not Air Force One, but it could be Air Force One. There's something that determines whether it's Air Force One or not. Do you know what it is? The presence of the president. There's actually two Boeing 747s that have been specially built. They're exactly identical, and they look like this one. This is one. This one happens to be SAM 2800 or something like that, the call sign, which will be its call sign if the president is not in it. The official Air Force One is any airplane that the president of the United States happens to be in. It officially becomes Air Force One at that very moment he steps into it. Right? So it just depends on the function it has, this plane, you know, what it's going to be called. And so if the angel is serving the function of the angel of the Lord, then he can be the angel of the Lord. But usually in the Old Testament, that was Christ. In the pre-incarnate time, that was Jesus Christ. Now, God has made contact with man through Christ and the angels. And I wanted to show you some points on that. And let's turn first to 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 6. He says, but to us there is but one God, the Father. Now notice the language carefully, especially these prepositions. Of whom are all things, and we in him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. He says all things originate and they come from God, but they're through or by Jesus Christ. And so these revelations of God, these expressions of God, God stands at Mount Sinai and says, I am the Lord thy God. But it was actually the voice of Jesus Christ speaking. Because he is the Word of God, he is the translator of God. And I've mentioned to you before how if I go into a country that I don't understand the language, I have to have a translator just as you would. But I go to Peru, I speak, and I have a translator who speaks Spanish. And I might stand up in front of a congregation, I would say, good evening, my name is Alan Stump. I'm glad to be here. And the translator will say that exact same expression in Spanish. They will not say, he is Alan Stump. They'll say, I am Alan Stump. Now, he's not Alan Stump. He's someone else. But he speaks my exact words. And Christ is the translator of God. He comes and brings the very word of God to us. He is that angel that Stephen spoke of in Acts 7:38. He is the angel of the presence of God. Isaiah 63, if we could turn there. Isaiah 63 and verse 9. It says, in all their affliction, he was afflicted, and the angel of his presence saved them. The angel of his presence. The angel had the name Jehovah in him. We read that in Exodus 23 and verse 21. And so I think there's a good biblical precedent to teach this and to enunciate it. I'd also like to share with you, if I could, a statement from the Spirit of Prophecy or two. Since the sin of our first parents, there has been no direct communication between God and man. The Father has given the world into the hands of Christ, that through his mediatorial work he may redeem man and vindicate the authority and holiness of the law of God. All the communication between heaven and the fallen race has been through Christ. It was the Son of God that gave our first parents the promise of redemption. It was he who revealed himself to the patriarchs. Adam, Noah, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Moses understood the gospel. They looked for salvation through man's substitute and surety. These holy men of old held communion with the Savior who was to come to our world in human flesh. And some of them talked with Christ and heavenly angels face to face. Christ was not only the leader of the Hebrews in the wilderness, the angel in whom was the name of Jehovah and who, veiled in the cloudy pillar, went before the host, but it was he who gave the law to Israel. Amid the awful glory of Sinai, Christ declared in the hearing of all the people the 10 precepts of his Father's law. It was he who gave to Moses the law engraved upon the tables of stone. Patriarchs and Prophets, page 366. And then I have a couple paragraphs I'd like to share with you from the youth instructor. And this is from the year 1900, December the 20th. It will baffle the keenest intellect to interpret the divine manifestation of the burning bush. It was not a dream. It was not a vision. It was a living reality. Something that Moses saw with his eyes. He heard the voice of God calling to him out of the bush, and he covered his face, realizing that he stood in the immediate presence of God. God was conversing with humanity. Never could Moses describe the impression made upon his mind. Now notice the expressions. You know, God was there. God was speaking, the presence of God. But then she goes on, she starts speaking about Jesus Christ. This lesson contains instruction that is profitable for all. Here is revealed a symbol radiant with the glory of Christ, the great teacher, speaking about this experience at the burning bush, and said that this was Christ, the great teacher. The symbol chosen for the representation of the deity was not a cedar of Lebanon, but a lowly bush that seemingly had no attraction. This enshrined the infinite. The all-merciful God shrouded his glory in a most humble type, that Moses might look upon it and live. God declared, thou canst not see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. All the manifestations of God's glory have been shrouded that man might behold it and not be consumed. Veiled in a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night, God could honor finite man by communicating to him his will and imparting to him his grace. God's glory must be subdued and his majesty veiled that the weak vision of finite man might look upon it. Think of Christ's humiliation. He took upon himself fallen, suffering human nature, degraded and defiled by sin. He took our sorrows, bearing our grief and shame. He endured all the temptations wherewith man is beset. He united humanity with divinity. A divine spirit dwelt in a temple of flesh. He united himself with the temple. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, because by so doing he could associate with the sinful, sorrowing sons and daughters of Adam. And that's from the Youth Instructor of December 20, 1900. It's not a long article. I would encourage you to look it up and read the whole article. And you see how she talks about this manifestation of the glory of God, and then she relates it to Jesus Christ. And that this was one who was a divine spirit that came and dwelt in a temple of flesh. Instead of coming and burning in a great cedar of Lebanon in a lowly bush. It was a prefigurement of the incarnation, of Christ coming to dwell in fallen, sinful flesh. Now, I think there's a couple passages that are just so meaningful, and yet, if we read them quickly, superficially, we're going to miss them. But I want to share with you a couple of those passages about the angel of the Lord. And one is in 1 Kings chapter 19. 1 Kings chapter 19, we're going to begin in verse 5. Poor Elijah, he had such a great victory on Mount Carmel, and then he ran away from this apostate woman, Jezebel. And he became very discouraged. But in verse 5, after going on a journey, as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold then, an angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat. And this was the angel of the Lord that came to him. And he touched him. He could have just said, wake up. But he touched him. He came close and he touched him. And I think that is so precious. Continuing on, it says, and he looked and behold, there was a cake baked on the coals and a cruse of water at his head. And he did eat and drink and laid him down again. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him. And said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. Friends, in our needs, whether they're physical, mental, emotional, whatever needs we have, the angel of the Lord comes to touch us and to help us, to bring just the very help that we need. And many times he came and he appeared in human likeness. And we could look at many examples. I'll just turn one in Judges chapter 6. You remember the story of Gideon? Gideon was threshing wheat by the winepress because of the Midianites in verse 12. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, the Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor. And Gideon said unto him, oh my Lord, if the Lord be with us, why then is all this befallen us? And he just spoke to him just like he was a person. He came and just as a person. We know the Lord came and he met Abraham at the plain of Mamre. And so he has done this. He's revealed himself to us. And while in character, Jesus is the express image of the Father's person. He alone could come and bring divinity to humanity. He alone could come and die for humanity where the Father could not. Because according to the Bible, the Father could not die. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, if we could turn there, beginning in verse 14. Notice the flow of the language, the context is very important. It says, that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable, until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which in his times he shall shew. Now, the his and the he, these are pronouns, and who they refer to? According to the context. They refer to Jesus Christ, don't they? Look at verse 14. The appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which in his times he shall shew. He's going to shew somebody, or show somebody. Who's he going to show? Who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who only hath immortality, dwelling in the light which no man can approach him to. Now we realize that this is speaking of an absolute immortality, because there's going to come a time when this mortal shall put on immortality. Isn't that right? The Bible promises that one day we will have immortality. But it's speaking about an absolute immortality that cannot die, and one in which no man can see or approach into that light. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 29 that our God is a consuming fire. His presence of holiness and greatness is as a consuming fire to sin, and we cannot approach His face and live. He must veil Himself. But His Son can come and accept fallen, sinful flesh and come down to where we're at. Not only could He become the angel of the Lord, but He could become the apostle of God, the one who was sent. Well, we just made reference to it in Exodus 33, verse 20. God told Moses, no man can see my face and live. And it's just too much for us. But Jesus Christ, who is the express image of the Father's person, in other words, His character, could come and accept fallen, sinful humanity. He could take upon His sinless nature our sinful nature. And Romans chapter 8, in verses 3 and 4, Romans chapter 8, verses 3 and 4. It says, for what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. Now, He did this, He says in verse 4, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. And so, God's people, though we have flesh, just as Jesus had, we can live by the Spirit, just as Jesus did. In Romans chapter 1 and verse 3, Paul says concerning His Son Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David, how? According to the flesh. And that's important. It says that He was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. In Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 16, it says, for verily He took not on Him the nature of angels, but He took on Him the seed of Abraham. Well, that's right. And the seed of David would be the seed of Abraham. It says, wherefore in all things it behooved Him to be made like unto His brethren, that He might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. For in that He Himself has suffered being tempted, He is able. Because of what He has done, He is able to help those who are tempted. Because He came and took our nature and took sinful flesh upon Him, then we can be victorious. Now, we come into now a little sensitive area that we need to understand. And that is, did Jesus Christ come in every exact respect as I do, or as I come into this world? Was He in every exact respect as the normal human being is in this world? Because it says here that He was made all things like unto His brethren. But there's something else we have to add in this equation. It's in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 5. And this parallels something that we read in Romans 1:3. Wherefore, when He cometh into the world, He saith, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a what? A body hast thou prepared me. Now, who is the me?
Jesus.
It's Jesus Christ. Would you agree with that? But it's significant that we have to understand this is a me. This is someone real. This is a person. It's not just a blank slate of nothingness. Someone who is a real person, who has a spirit. Now, in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 5, we know that verse. It says, let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus. It says, let this mind be in you. Why do we have to have that mind, friends? Because we don't have that mind. When we are born in this world, we are not born with such a mind as Jesus Christ had. If we would turn with me to Romans chapter 8 again, in verse 6. It says, for to be carnally minded is death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of His. And if Christ be in you. The body is dead because of sin, but the spirit is life because of righteousness. Now, beloved, in a physical sense, in an anatomical sense, we are all in flesh. We all have flesh. And Paul's not speaking about these people that somehow they have become disembodied spirits and they're not living in flesh anymore. That's not what he's speaking about. He's speaking about what is controlling the person. What is ruling in that person's life? Is it the flesh and the things of the flesh that are controlling? He says, because if it is, there's death and only death because the carnal mind is enmity. It is at war against God. And I have shuddered to hear some people say that Jesus had a carnal mind. I've heard this. In an effort to try to make sure that they bring him all the way down so that he can be our complete and perfect example. And he is, friends, and we're going to explain this. But he did not have a carnal mind. He did not have a sinful mind. He had a pure mind. And that's why we are told to have the mind of Christ Jesus. We need to understand something, that the mind and the brain are not the same thing. The brain is part of your flesh. And it's sinful. But the mind is something different. And the mind operates primarily through our brains, through this nervous system that centers and functions primarily in our cranial cavity. But it's something very different. And we can have the Spirit of Christ. There's a statement in Signs of the Times, if we could go to our next slide. We need a constant sense of the ennobling power of pure thoughts and the damning influence of evil thoughts. Thoughts have to do with your mind, don't they? And we need pure thoughts. It says, let us place our thoughts upon holy things. Let them be pure and true. For the only security for any soul is right thinking. We are to use every means that God has placed within our reach for the government and cultivation of our thoughts. We are to bring our minds into harmony with Christ's mind. His truth will sanctify us, body, soul, and spirit, and we shall be enabled to rise above temptations. Signs of the Times, August 23, 1905. She also says in the youth instructor, in our next slide, of May 16, 1901, the Christian has the mind that is in Christ. Now, she doesn't say everybody has that mind. Who has that mind? The Christian. His hopes and aspirations are what? Pure and noble, for he is growing up unto Christ. Now, in 1888, God sent two special men to the General Conference held at Minneapolis to proclaim a very special message. And for the next decade or so, that message was rung loud and clear by A.T. Jones and E.J. Wagoner. In the 1895 General Conference, A.T. Jones was speaking about the Incarnation and its importance to us. And I want you to just read something that he said here, as found in the General Conference Bulletin of February the 25th of 1895. He says, now as to Christ not having like passions with us, in the Scriptures, all the way through, he is like us and with us according to the flesh. He is the seed of David according to the flesh. He was made in the likeness of sinful flesh. Don't go too far. He was made in the likeness of sinful flesh, not in the likeness of sinful mind. Do not drag his mind into it. His flesh was our flesh, but the mind was the mind of Christ Jesus. Continuing, Jones said, therefore it is written, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. If he had taken our mind, how then could we have ever been exhorted to let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus? It would have been so already. But what kind of mind is ours? Oh, it is corrupted with sin also. Now notice the date on this. It's February 25, 1895, because we're going to come back to a date very close to this in a little bit. Now, as people have studied a little bit about the truth of God, we should understand some things very basically. Now, just quickly go over a few things. In Isaiah chapter 40, verse 13, it says, who hath directed the Spirit of the Lord, or being his counselor, hath taught him? Notice the expression, who hath directed the Spirit of the Lord? Now, keep your hand here in Isaiah. But I want you now to turn to Romans chapter 11, in verse 34. It says, for who hath known the mind of the Lord, or who hath been his counselor? And if you have a marginal reference Bible, if you look in your references for Romans 11:34, you're probably going to see Isaiah 40:13. And if you're in Isaiah 40:13, you look in the reference, you're going to see Romans 11:34. You're also going to see 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 16, because Paul quotes this verse also. Paul is quoting here, but it sounds a little different, doesn't it? Because in Isaiah, he says, who hath directed the Spirit of the Lord? And in the New Testament, who has known the mind of the Lord? So you have mind and spirit interchanged. And that's because in the Septuagint version of the Old Testament, which was the Bible Paul was quoting from, it interchanges the word spirit and mind. Because they understood the spirit and the mind to be synonymous concepts. And Paul says there's validity to that. I mean, he shows that that's an accurate translation because he quotes it. He wouldn't quote it if it wasn't right. Or he corrected it, you see. And also in Ezekiel chapter 11 and verse 15, there it speaks about the spirit and the mind, but they're both translated from the same Hebrew word, ruach. The word for spirit and mind. The same. And that reminds me of something we read earlier, and I'm just going to put it up on the screen again to remind you. In the youth instructor of December 20, 1900, it says a divine spirit dwelt in a temple of flesh. Do you remember that? Mm-hmm. Do you believe that's true? Do you think that the prophet had insight to understand it correctly? And if mind and spirit could be interchanged, then could I, without doing violence to the reference, say that a divine mind dwelt in a temple of flesh? That would be accurate, wouldn't it? A divine mind. This me of Hebrews chapter 10, verse 5. A body thou hast prepared me. That was someone very important. Someone very special. And he wants to live in us today. And he will live in us today if we'll let him. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 27, it says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. And the Lord is that Spirit, 2 Corinthians 3:17. And the Bible says that he that is joined unto the Lord is what? One Spirit. Our bodies being the temple of the Spirit of God. In other words, the miracle of Bethlehem that happened almost 2,000 years ago is reproduced in Jesus Christ, in each one of us. Amen. The divine spirit coming and dwelling in a temple of flesh. And that's what God wants to do for us. Now, it's true, friends. I wasn't born conceived of the Holy Spirit like Jesus Christ was. In Matthew chapter 1, verse 20, it says that he was conceived of the Holy Spirit. I wasn't. In Luke 1:35, it says that he was that holy thing. And if you look at the Greek carefully, a better translation is Holy Spirit. Because the word thing, if you look in your King James Bible, thing is a supplied word. It may not show it's supplied, but it's actually supplied in the Greek. Holy is an adjective and has to modify something. But because it's a neuter, it has to refer to something that's neuter. And the only thing that comes close to that in the verse itself is Spirit. That Holy Spirit, which will be born of you, will be called the Son of God. I didn't have that experience. But you know what? I can be born again. I can be born again. And then I can have the Spirit of God. You know, this concept that Jesus had no advantage over us, in its most absolute sense, is actually heresy. Because if he had no advantage in any way over me, then whatever he did, I literally can do too. But there's not a single human being who can avoid what it says in Romans 3:23. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And every one of us, our lives testify and are proof of that. But Jesus did no sin. But he had this divine spirit. And friends, he offers that spirit to each one of us. So he had no advantage that is not available to us. Amen. I think that's a nice way to say it. And it's an accurate way to say it. That he had no advantage that is not fully available to us that we cannot access. And so we can have the mind of Christ. We can receive of his Spirit. And this is a beautiful proposition the Lord makes to us. Christ was the Prince of Heaven, but he made an infinite sacrifice and came to a world all marred with the curse brought upon it by the fallen foe. He lays hold of the fallen race. He invites us, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. The offer is ours. And every advantage is ours if we will accept the terms. You see, there's advantages that we need, but they're not ours unless we accept the terms. I am trying to do this most earnestly. We can be an example to others by our cheerful obedience to the will of God. Let us comply with the conditions, and in complying we shall find the rest we crave. That's from the Review and Herald of August 6, 1914. In our next slide, from Signs of the Times, May 27, 1897. Christ's example shows us that our only hope of victory is in continual resistance of Satan's attacks. He who triumphed over the adversary of souls in the conflict with temptations understands Satan's power over the race and has conquered it in our behalf. As an overcomer, he has given us the advantage of his victory, that in our efforts to resist the temptation of Satan, we may unite our weakness to his strength, our worthlessness to his merits, and sustained by his enduring might under strong temptation, we may resist in his all-powerful name and overcome as he overcame. Isn't that beautiful? It is a great thing to believe in Jesus. We hear many say, believe, believe. All you have to do is to believe in Jesus. But it is our privilege to inquire, what does this belief take in? And what does it comprehend? There are many of us who have a nominal faith, but we do not bring that faith into our characters. We must have that faith which works by love and purifies the soul. That this belief in Christ will lead us to put away everything that is offensive in his sight. Unless we have this faith that works, it is of no advantage to us. You admit that Christ is the Savior of the world, but is he your Savior? Do you believe today that he will give you strength and power to overcome every defect in your character? And that's in Heavenly Places, page 118. Friends, if he had no more or less than we have, then do I need his strength and power to overcome? I mean, it would be absurd to say that. Jesus said, all power in heaven is given to me, heaven and earth, and it's true, all authority. But because of his Spirit coming into our lives, we have this great advantage. Now, I've intentionally tried to proceed at a pretty rapid pace, because I want to share with you in closing now something that will be just a little long for a close, okay? But I think that you'll find this advantageous. And in fact, I would encourage each one of you to read the entirety of what I'm only going to read you a portion of. Remember, we mentioned that A.T. Jones, one of those special messengers that God sent to his people in 1888, had some special messages at the 1895 General Conference. He also had some at the 1893 General Conference. And that one of them was given on February the 25th. And there he said, wait a minute, now don't go too far. Don't drag his mind into this. It's because of what he had said the day before. And he wanted to make sure that the words that he said the day before weren't taken too far. So when we read these statements we're going to read now from A.T. Jones, the February 24th, 1895 General Conference, remember that the day after he said, but be careful, don't drag his mind into it. Okay? So we're going to begin our next slide. This is A.T. Jones, the General Conference Bulletin of February 24th, 1895. In Jesus Christ alone is the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man. And in Jesus Christ we find the brotherhood of man only when we find Christ, the brother of every man. It is written, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren. Not ashamed to call who brethren? Every one that is flesh and blood. Christ is not ashamed to call him brother. He is not ashamed to go and take him by the hand, even though his breath does smell of liquor, and say, come with me and let us go a better way. That is the brotherhood of man. It has been Satan's work always to get men to think that God is far away as possible. But it is the Lord's everlasting effort to get men to find out that he is as near to everyone as possible. So it is written, he is not far from every one of us. The great trouble with heathenism was to think that God was so far away. Not only far away, but full of wrath at them all, and only waiting to get a chance to pick them up and savagely shake them and plunge them into perdition. So viewing him, they made offerings to get him in a good humor and to keep him from hurting them. But he was not far from every one of them all the time. Not far, that is near, so near, that all they had to do was to feel after him. Although they were blind and in the dark too, all they had to do was to feel after him and they would find him, referencing Acts 17:21-28. Then the papacy came in, the very incarnation of that enmity between man and God. Let me just pause there. Jesus Christ is the incarnation of the love between God and man, and the papacy is the very incarnation of the enmity between Satan and man. Jones goes on to say, this incarnation of evil entered under the name of Christianity, and it again puts God and Christ so far away that nobody can come near to them. Everybody else comes in before God. Then in addition to all this, he is so far away that Mary and her mother and her father and all the rest of the Catholic saints, clear down to Joan of Arc and Christopher Columbus pretty soon, all these have to come in between God and man so as to make such a connection that all can be sure that they are noticed by him. But this is all of Satan's invention. Christ is not so far away as that. He is not far enough away to get a single relation in between him and me, or between him and you. And this is just where God wants us to view him, so near that it is impossible for anything or anybody to get between. But to how many people has he come so near? He is not far from every one of us, even the heathen. The incarnation of that enmity that is against God and that separates between man and God. The papacy built up this, and now here is this same thought that we mentioned a moment ago. The false idea that he is so holy that it would be entirely unbecoming in him to come near to us and be possessed of such a nature as we have, sinful, depraved, fallen human nature. Therefore, Mary must be born immaculate, perfect, sinless, and higher than the cherubim and seraphim. And then Christ must be so born of her as to take his human nature in absolute sinlessness from her. But that puts him further away from us than the cherubim and the seraphim are, and in a sinless nature. But if he comes no nearer to us than in a sinless nature, that is a long way off. Because I need somebody that is nearer to me than that. I need someone to help me who knows something about sinful nature. For that is the nature that I have, and such the Lord did take. He became one of us. Thus, you see, this is present truth in every respect. Now the papacy is taking possession of the world. Amen to that. That's happening so rapidly. The papacy is taking possession of the world, and the image of it is going on in the wrong way, forgetting all that God is in Jesus Christ and all that Christ is in the world, having the form of godliness without the reality, without the power. In this day, it is not just the thing that is needed in the world, that God should proclaim the real merits of Christ once more and his holiness. It is true. He is holy. He is altogether holy. But his holiness is not that kind that makes him afraid to be in the company with people who are not holy for fear he will get his holiness spoiled. Anybody who has such a kind of holiness that they cannot be found in the company in the name of Jesus Christ of people who are fallen and lost and degraded without spoiling it would be better get rid of it as quickly as possible and get the right kind, because that kind of holiness is not worth having. It is already spoiled. It is one of the most blessed truths in the Bible that our God is a consuming fire because of his holiness. For then in Jesus Christ we meet him whose holiness is a consuming fire to sin, and that is the pledge of our salvation in perfection from every stain of sin. The brightness, the glory, and all the consuming purity of that holiness will take every vestige of sin and sinfulness out of the man who will meet God in Christ Jesus. Thus, in his true holiness, Christ could come and did come to sinful men in sinful flesh where sinful men are. Thus, in Christ and in Christ alone is found the brotherhood of all men. All indeed are one in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Some have found, and all may find in the testimonies, the statement that Christ has not like passions as we have. The statement is there. Everyone may find it there, of course. And he says, some have drawn the conclusion some time ago, and you can see what a fearful conclusion it is, that Christ became ourself. He is our flesh. Therefore, I am Christ. They say Christ forgave sins. I can forgive sins. He wrought miracles. I must work miracles. That is a fearful argument. There are no two ways about it. Continuing, Jones says, Christ became ourselves in our place, weak as we are, and in all points like as we are, in order that he might be that forever and never that we should be himself. No, it is God who is to be manifested always and not ourselves. In order that this might be, Christ emptied himself and took ourselves in order that God himself might come to us, appear in us, and be revealed in us, and through us in all things. It was always God and never ourselves. That which ruined us at the start was the exaltation of ourselves, the setting forth of ourselves, and the putting of ourselves above God. In order that we might get rid of our wicked selves, Christ emptied his righteous self and stood in the place of our wicked selves and crucified ourselves, putting ourselves underfoot always, in order that God might be all in all. And then he concludes, he says, how much? All? All in how many? All. It was done that God might be all that there is in me, and all there is in you, and all there is in Christ. Assuredly, that is what this was done for. We are not to exalt ourselves. Christ is to increase, I am to decrease. He is to live, I am to die. He is to be exalted, I am to be emptied. And that's what the angel of the Lord is all about. That he comes and he takes us and he lifts us up. And this was stated on February the 24th, or published in the Bulletin of February 24. And the next day in the Bulletin of February 25, he says, now wait a minute, don't go too far though. Don't take my remarks the wrong way. He says, don't drag his mind into it. His mind was ever pure. It was the mind of Christ. He says, now there's a couple of things that we have to access or think about. In Hebrews chapter 2, we read that he was made in all things like unto his brethren. So why wasn't his mind made like our mind either? Now, there's a couple different slants on that. I've heard some people say, well, you know, the context is his brethren. And his brethren are the people who are Christians, who are converted. So he's made in every respect like we were made. But of course, Jones, as we've read, Jones disagreed with that. Because Jones said the brotherhood of man says he comes to everyone in fallen flesh. And he specifically speaks about the drunkard. He says, come, get out of the ditch and let's go a better way. And so maybe Jones wouldn't agree with that point. But I would like to think that if we would look at Hebrews chapter 10, verse 5, and consider that verse. We read it earlier. We don't have to go back to it now. But in Hebrews 10, 5, it says, the body thou hast prepared me. In everything that was prepared, and everything that was made, he was made exactly like us. But the one thing that wasn't made was his spirit. He retained his spirit. He wasn't someone else. He wasn't a new creature in the sense that he had a new identity and he had lost his identity from heaven. He never did that, friends. He may have lost certain memories. As a child, he had to grow up and he didn't have those memories of being in heaven. But he was the same person. He was the same spirit. And that he never forfeited. But he offers us that mind today. He says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Let this spirit. And so we can have, and we've been told over and over in spirit prophecy, that the success in the Christian life is dependent upon the blending of humanity and what? Divinity. And if we don't have divinity blended with humanity, we'll never have success. And if it's this divine mind that dwells in the spirit of flesh, friends, that's what we need today. And I want the life of Christ living in me today. And I believe with all my heart that it is the key to victory over sin. And whether we're going to let him in or not, that's up to us. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will hear my voice, open the door. I will come in and will sup with him and he with me. But the angel of the Lord wants to do that for each one of us today. And he will if we'll let him.